The El Royale is a rundown hotel that sits on the border between California and Nevada, and it soon becomes a seedy battleground when seven strangers, a priest, a soul singer, a traveling salesman, two sisters, the hotel manager, and the mysterious Billy Lee all converge on one fateful night. Now, no movie is perfect, and this one is no different, so let's discuss some of the pros and cons of Bad Times at the El Royale. Some pros? The cast. This is a movie that is filled with wild and kooky characters, and for how bizarre their individual personalities can be, they all still feel like well-rounded and well-written three-dimensional characters. And while that probably has a great deal to do with the actual writing, you cannot deny how fantastic the performances are, because the actors really make these crazy characters come to life. Jeff Bridges, John Hamm, and Chris Hemsworth are incredible here. Cynthia Erivo, for a new actress, delivers a great scene-stealing performance and has a wonderfully talented singing voice. And more surprisingly, Dakota Johnson has a very memorable presence in the film, proving that she's far more talented than what you may have expected if you've only ever seen her in the 50 Shades franchise. I even enjoyed Lewis Pullman as the young, awkward, and psychologically damaged hotel concierge. These actors made their respective characters feel like very unique and distinct individuals. But I won't get into details about specific characteristics, because trying to figure out who is who and why everyone is at this hotel and what their motivations may be is all part of the fun. All I can say is, I was so impressed with the acting that I can't even pick out a favorite performance. Everyone did a great job. The style. Bad Times at the El Royale feels very much like a stage play. Maybe that has something to do with the singular hotel setting, but even the way certain shots are framed or the way certain story points unravel gives El Royale a very theatrical atmosphere. It has a very whodunit feel to it, which makes sense given that most of the narrative is shrouded in mystery. But Drew Goddard's signature directorial style makes this dark, neo-noir thriller come to life and feel fun. Originality. This is a very unique film that feels very fresh and original. From the wacky cast of characters, to the narrative structure, to the directorial flair, I can honestly say that I've never really seen anything quite like Bad Times at the El Royale. I had a lot of fun with this creative and inventive film, and it's probably one of my favorite original stories of the entire year, and that's all thanks to Drew Goddard. Drew Goddard is an excellent storyteller. I've loved all of his work, from his directorial debut with Cabin in the Woods to even his smaller work on television like with Daredevil. I just really enjoy the way he's able to balance dark themes with a fun tone. All of his projects feature dark, violent, and gloomy subject matter, yet he still manages to make the narrative joyously entertaining. And that is no different with Bad Times at the El Royale. If Sony really wanted to have a successful cinematic universe of Spider-Man characters, then they should have let Goddard do his take on the Sinister Six. Instead, we have a universe that's going to be built on the shaky foundation of Venom. And despite the box office take, Bad Times is a much better film than Venom by a long shot. And though I'm sure Goddard could fix Sony's train wreck of a franchise, I'm glad he gets to pursue his own original ideas instead. I can't wait to see what kind of imaginative story he has to tell next. The soundtrack. Though the trailers don't indicate as much, Bad Times at the El Royale is actually set in 1969. The movie itself does a better job of showcasing the time period, but the best way the film gives away its older setting is through the choice of music. I loved the soundtrack, and would probably buy it if I could find it anywhere. I'm not sure if movies have been increasingly getting better with their music selection ever since the release of Guardians of the Galaxy, or if my own awareness of musical soundtracks has just grown since then, but either way, the music in Bad Times at the El Royale was great, and made the film all the more fun. But to move into some cons, the only quarrel I really have with El Royale is probably its running time. At 2 hours and 22 minutes, the movie does run a bit long, and with Goddard's meticulously crafted script, you will have to pay attention to every minute in order to enjoy the full narrative. I personally appreciated Goddard's attention to detail, but I can see how the long running time can wane on some people's experience. But other than that, I very much loved this original character-driven film, as I would probably give Bad Times at the El Royale 4.25 out of 5 stars. Thanks for watching.